there's going to be more EEB classes added to the roster for the spring?
No.
It's kind of October for classes for me, in spring. Terrifying.
Yeah, you probably not be anything added.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because there's maybe one class in the EEB I want to take in the spring.
Yeah.
I need to take two classes.
Let me start with the EEB catalog. Let me start class, but first, one thing. So tomorrow at 2:45, there's something run by EB on getting into grad school. And not only getting into grad school here. I mean, you should apply to many places if you were thinking of going to grad school. So it'll tell you what's involved in the process, how you do it, what grad school is like. Okay? Any questions about that? You know, usually in this class, you know, there's usually a handful of students who actually apply to grad school out of this class. Choose to go. So, and also, there's always this, also some grad, people who are already grad students from this class. You can talk to them too. See if they look happy or not. Because you don't. All right, so today we're talking about trends, right? So, on things like body size and things like that. Here's an interesting body size evolution, right? So, you've seen, you know, what would you call this? A common name?
Pillbug.
Roly poly. Yeah. Isopod, right? So it's actually a crustacean, right, that was on land. And their relatives in the ocean can get very, very big. So here's one attacking, not really, a scientist.
Is that one alive?
What? No. No. Preserved. But, you know, let's just see how much, I mean, it's a huge size variation between those things. And so how do you evolve this size variation? Is there a trend over time in this size? Right, have the ones in the ocean gotten bigger through time and the ones on land gotten smaller through time? It's happening. Okay. First, quick clicker review question. Channel 41. Okay, 1 minute. Sorry. Okay, so here's results. So, this isn't a democracy. Majority might not always be right, right? So defend your view. So people thought A. Why A? Yeah.
It was easier to be used earlier.
Why?
Regeneration is faster and multicellularity means complexities that may be not useful in harsh environments.
Okay. Why would that have changed? Why would that be more true early on?
Because the environment.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, good. B. There's no defense for it. I'll make sure it's the wrong answer.
It's kind of like self-explanatory, isn't it? Like, cells want to reproduce, and at the early stages, a multicellular organism, like, every cell is going to want to, but if every cell doesn't get to, and it makes the drive to reproduce, generate an offspring, and be too strong. So it would conflict with the working togetherness of the cellularity.
Right, there's always selection for individual reproduction. Right, so you have to overcome that have group selection. Okay, good. C? Okay, well, it's wrong. So, yeah, I mean, hundreds of millions of years passed from origin of life to origin of things like crinoids and trilobites. D? No, no one like that.
I almost put that, actually.
Okay, why?
Just because cosmic bubble, I mean, it would take time to build up like multicellularity, and if it was early on repeated from cosmic bombardment, then it would make the environment too harsh. It wouldn't be stable enough for multicellularity with like a slower generation of times and just more complexity, more energy requirements. It just wouldn't be useful in that kind of situation.
Which is true, but things cosmic bombardment decreased radically. So, it had there been a continual cosmic bombardment, that would be true, but there wasn't. So you chose wisely. So I was going to say the correct answer is B, but I mean, the case made for A was strong enough, I'll make it so that A and B are both right answers. C people, too bad. Okay, any other questions about that? All right. So, Cope's rule.
I talked about this a little bit already.
Widespread trend of many animals to get bigger through time, right? And so, what could explain a trend in general? Right? So, we've talked about body size a lot. The thing was the other trend. What could you help you explain another trend? For example, let's go to multicellularity, right? So, earlier, had no multicellular animals, plants. Right, now you have less multicellular things. Right, so over time, there's been a trend of increasing amount of multicellularity. Why might that be?
Maybe it goes a little with the larger thing. If you're bigger, you can eat the. If you're multicellular, you're larger, and you can maybe engulf and eat the unicellular organisms more easily.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Right. Good. What else? Yep.
Oh, you have more virus. I feel like viruses or other predators would be able to choose readily. If you're multicellular, you can fight off a viral infection faster than this unicellular organism. Like, if you're unicellular, you're screwed. But maybe you have enough time to adapt to stop the spread of the virus if you're multicellular.
That's interesting. I don't think that's been thought about before. But yeah, that could be the case, right? So if you're single celled, you're infected, tough luck. But me, my finger gets infected, well, maybe the rest of me can fix that or lop off my finger or something.
Yeah.
Well, lizards do that with their tails, right? So,
yeah.
Not for infection. But. What else?
Each cell uses proportionally less energy.
Okay, each cell uses less energy proportionally. Why?
Just because it's sharing between all the cells.
Mm-hmm. So you could have efficiencies of scale in some way. Maybe you only need to have one cell grow a motility organ and the others don't have to or something like that. Okay, good. What else? These are all selective reasons. Are there other reasons besides selection that could lead to a trend?
Cell doesn't split properly, so you end up multicellular mass.
Mm-hmm. Right, so you can get, you know, cells divide stickily, and then get, you know, they can get more than through time if they, you know, survive equally well. But you can always, you know, get stickier, but can't get less sticky or something like that. Good. That could lead to a trend. Yeah.
Could be like some kind of tag along trait, like it's closely related to something that's really advantageous, but it's like hard to just purge that one thing, so it might just go with it.
Mm-hmm. Right, so some correlation between traits is necessary. So you don't want to end up selecting on the drag along. Good. Yep.
We've got the whole fixation due to drift thing, right? So it's trying to happen because of just time drifting that way.
Couldn't you have it drift the other way, though, too?
Life could be a bit different than it is now if you wanted to.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so it could be just an artifactual trend, right? That, you know, by chance we have things that look this way, and so we have things that have been a trend this way, by chance it could have been the other way. Yeah, okay, good? Yeah. Okay, how so?
Like back in the day, there were high these seeds as we have now, so there was a greater availability of resources. So, I mean, there would be selection pressure to get bigger to devour more of the resources before other seeds could devour.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Good. So, first, you know, life was simple, there were a few niches. Now, life will get more complex, more niches, and so you can have more variability. Good. Now, we have something called a passive trend. Good, very good. Other thoughts? Okay, so we can always make these possible explanations for trends we see, right? What makes evolution a science rather than just, you know, telling just so stories is the testing of it, right? So how would you test these things? Measure metabolic efficiency. It's true. They did that for looking at jellyfish swimming. I found jellyfish were amazingly efficient swimmers compared to other things.
You could look at sister taxa. Maybe if they're really similar, if there's a size difference, or even like different size morphs in the same species.
Mm-hmm.
Like try to compare their sort of fitness. And like, is it better to be bigger or not?
Mm-hmm. Right. So you have some mechanism, like you think you could eat more things or. You survive better. You could test that by doing controlled comparisons. Good. What else could you do? Oh, they have a next question about like trends in eye complexity in trilobites. So they've got these cool eyes. I can't, you know, test how they see you now because they're all dead. So what can I do? Not to explain the trend, but to test. So I can imagine multiple hypotheses, right? So I can imagine that, you know, cool eyes are sexually selected, right? The more dazzling your eyes are, the more mates you have. Or I can imagine that it's related to predation pressure in the environment. Or I can say it evolves because they evolve more complex neural circuitry and so can better process visual imagery. So like one thing I could do is to create a model, and then I could say, okay, let's assume the model is correct. Will the model generate stuff that looks like my real data? Right? And if so, then it suggests the model might be right. If not, it says that model is wrong. And if there's some other models that say right, it says that model doesn't explain at all. Good. Yeah. Think using modern analogs. So I'm working with a postdoc now who's looking at how terrestrial locomotion evolved. And so she takes things like salamanders that move a different way from lizards that move a different way from mud skippers, these fish that sort of hop around on their bellies on land. And she's looking at them as sort of models for how early vertebrates could come on land. So, yep. Also building robots, building an aquatic robot.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So what? Well, why would that? I mean, I agree, clearly. Why would they do that? Mm-hmm. Right, so you can look at the trend, see, you know, there's something where I had this evolving repeatedly, maybe in response to another factor, something where everything just has this trend through time, so this is some constant factor leading to it. Good. Okay. So, one discussion in the trend literature is active versus passive trend. All right, so here I have two phylogenies. Okay. And they'll start off near zero, and then the distance on the x-axis is the trait value, so the body size, and the y-axis is time. So what's different about these?
There's completely different distributions, like one's being more skewed to the left and one's sort of more
sort of. Yeah, well, they're both unimodal, so modal means like the height of the peak, but right. But one is definitely like skewed and one's sort of nice and normal. Good. What else do you notice about the difference? A has more sort of outliers, right? Here, over there. Good. What about the sort of direction along the through time on the branches? How are you measuring diversity in this case? No, the x-axis is like a trait, like body size or eye size. So, for example, here, like this, you know, went from 0 to 1, back to 0, up to 5.1, whatever, next thing, and same thing all over here. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yep.
So it seems to be, you know, an average goes this way along the branches.
Here, like with here, going right or left, it seems like. Right?
Yeah. That one doesn't
have a distribution. Yep, because it's not really true. This one effectively is. Yeah. Good. So this one goes left and right, which means that on average, so they start off at zero, on average they're at zero at the end. Is that true? This is a subtle but important point. Or to be closer to zero in A, mm-hmm. Is it, you know, at zero? No. It's greater than zero. Right? And through time I've moved away from zero from my average. So that's sort of a trend, right? That is increase in size through time. It's not from everything continually increasing, it's definitely left and right to the probability. So what causes it to move only one, what causes the average to move one way? Chance, so it could be that, you know, they've written this again and have it over here, right? Is there something, some sort of barrier you see on this plot?
You can't, like, have a negative body size, so there's only one way to go when you're all the way to the left.
Mm-hmm. Right, so you notice I have these negative values in the axis, but they don't get below zero. Right, it's probably not actually body size, it's like you know, start at zero and then don't have zero body size, but.
Right, so it's probably a little bit right zero.
I can't get to the left, I can't get past this line. Right, so what? Right, so maybe A, you're gonna have some greater, you know, this way and this way and this way and this way. Here it's always one way. How does having, let's say there is a boundary at zero, could that lead to a trend?
Yeah.
So even since there is that barrier, it's going to be a slight push to get away from it, just maybe a lot slower.
Right, so it could be,
then you call it a reflecting boundary, an absorbing boundary, right? Where if you go this way, then you go low fitness, if you go here, you go to zero fitness, right? So if it's wandering randomly right and left, those that go left disappear, those that go right survive fine, so there's bias and things that happen to go right, right? If I put you on, you know, this, if I stood on this table, right? If I move this way, I'm fine. If I move this way too far, I fall off, right? You have a whole bunch of factors on the table. The ones that survive went this way, the ones that die went that way. Right? So that's what we call an absorbing boundary. What kind of boundaries would I have? Yeah.
Maybe once I reach that boundary, instead of doing less well, they do more well, and just stay there.
Okay. Yeah, so
they can just stay at that boundary. So the still things that move this way and do fine, they have still have their own trend, although it's something that's sort of stuck there. Good?
Yep. It's not something we actually have a word for, we don't have to think about that, but you're right, that could happen. Good. What else? I would have had you all stand,
you know, against this wall. Okay. And then said, okay, you can up or down. How these we should keep up to the room change? In random, yep, and move this way, right? And it's telling you to move this way, if you maybe you want to, right? But you know, can't move this way, so you have to move this way. So you know that we're fucking down. Okay. And so
both of those can lead, both the absorbing and putting boundaries can lead to this sort of, we call it passive trend. Where, you know, we're not being a strong selective force, say a higher number, because we can't get further one way, so we either stay where we are or move one direction to cause this bias. Okay. And so we'll use this to talk about complexity. We'll have lots of questions about, like, why is life getting more complex through time? What could just be this passive trend thing, right? You start off with a very simple life, the only way it goes up. Right? So life can be as simple or more complex. It can get more simple. Right? So you have, over time, you have this increasing variation, this bound as we get a greater mean. Make sense? Yeah? All right, what can lead to an active trend? What can lead to, so we call this other kind an active trend, where everything's being pulled in one way. What can lead to that?
Either like the mutational bias we talked about earlier, or just like selection in general.
Mm-hmm. Right. So if I said to you, okay, first people to get my wallet, you know, guess whatever's in it, and you actually thought I had money in it, right? You would all, you know, move this way towards this new optimum, right? And so that'd be sort of an active trend, right? Where everyone's moving in that direction, not just the ones closest to it, right? So we think about it as an active trend. Now, if you think about how things move,
is that path that we're talking about where, you know, you take over this way, and over here you can go in directions, you know, by chance right or left. Here, we, you know, almost always have this bias of moving right. We can move left, on occasion, but some of this overall bias doesn't move right.
Okay, and I use bias a lot in the class, and bias you don't mean, you know, I only hire people who are taller than me sort of thing. It's about that sort of human bias. It's bias in terms of statistical bias. More average to go, more likely to go one way than another way. Okay. Questions about this? Okay. So on the course website, you can download an R script to play with this if you want, where we can, you know, you can play with creating, having just generic drift, moving around from space, having a passive trend or having a driven trend. So you can see where things are moving through time.
So here we have comparisons of, you know, body mass through time. Okay, so here we have each line here represents a species or a genus of mammals, in the duration of that and the body size.
So what do you see?
This you can sort of like squint and see a tree shape. It's actually not a tree. A bunch of species plotted in one plot.
Okay. What do you see as sort of a trend?
Through time. So time's going this way. Right here.
I mean, there's still this stuff down here. But yeah, it's
ignoring that bottom.
Okay.
Because it's darker, it's got more dark patches of the white and white.
Yeah, you have to be careful in science, you know, don't use the juicy bits, but yeah, I mean, that's what everyone does.
You see this part sort of going up, and these other stuff there. Okay. But the overall pattern is from small to big range. How would the mean change?
If I was doing some rolling mean of,
you know, average body size here, average body size here, average body size here.
Yeah, mean seems to be increasing,
right? So the mean of these is, you know, 80, 70 years time ago, it's quite like around here. Right at this point, around here. Point, and it's probably actually around here, right? You can add in this stuff, with this stuff, right? The mean seems to be increasing.
Alright, so it's a trend. Alright, what kind of trend is it? What do you think? I hear a vote for active, I hear a vote for passive. Defend active.
You can say the bottom half with the outliers, and that's why it's not in the spits. Because they're all being pulled. The majority of them in the roots of nature are being pulled to large size.
Okay. Getting your freak on. I guess
if it's active, does it have to be pulled towards like one optimum? If there's like some sort of adaptive landscape with multiple peaks, like I can just imagine it going in like all kinds of different directions, but still towards like not ranging.
That's true. So actually, we haven't talked about this yet, but there are models of evolution where you have
one optimum value on this plot, maybe like here, and an optimum value here. And so I could have species that, you know, are being pulled towards this optimum, and that species starts being pulled towards this optimum, right? And so if I happen to start it here, right, I have some to stay this way, and the bottom freaks, and the top ones might somehow get up here and be pulled towards this optimum, top freaks. Right, so that'd be some sort of mixture of two different active trends. Yep, good. And one thing that comes up is, you know, this is life, life is messy. So like, yeah, I can show you idealized things like this. Like, okay, this is pretty clear, right? But with actual data, it becomes a lot less clear. So you can imagine, you know, it's, you know, a mixture of, you know, passive here and active here, or different active peaks, that sort of thing.
So it's a tough question to ask. Okay. So one thing to look at is looking at ancestor descendant pairs. So this thing's done more in paleo than in phylogenetics. Okay. So I have a species, and I have its putative daughter species. And then you say, okay, how much have you changed? And I have another species and its putative daughter species. How much has that changed? And this one and this one, and so forth. Okay? What could be a problem with this sort of analysis? Might be missing something. So what? Alright, so I've missed, you know, this individual, this species.
Yeah.
Okay.
Will it change how much?
Right, so change how much it changed per speciation event, say. I could be normalizing it by time, though, and then if it's linear, it's still okay. No, that's good. Good thing, though. No, yeah, I mean, you're right. What else? Oh, he's be measuring some trait like body mass or something like that. Which is, it could be noisy, right? So I have a juvenile, do I have an adult, is there male female dimorphism? So that's a noisy measure. But it's actually measured from specimens, for example. Yep. What else? So this assignment of answers to sentence, not only can we be missing some intermediates along the way, but it could have, you know, the actual truth is this sort of tree, right? And I say, okay, this one is the ancestor of this one, right? And so I see this much change. But actually, it's not that, you know, I have it on this branch, it's actually some sister group, which makes more sense. And so what I've done is, overestimated the amount of change. When there's only, you know, this much change in this much time, actually it's this plus this time. Right? So you can estimate that way. And so right now, in terms of, you know, adding fossils to trees is actually a big fight now about whether fossils can actually be put on trees as sort of ancestors or actually are like sister groups. Right? But here we're just doing trees and fossils as ancestors of other fossils. Bias. Okay, so it's that issue. Okay. Leaving aside that, though, why might this be informative for trend direction? What kind of trend it is?
It seems like that would give you like instantaneous rate of change between two, but it doesn't connect all of them together. It doesn't sort of give you the whole
idea. Mm-hmm. Right. Instantaneous rates of change. But it could be the overall trend is, you know, hidden by those individual noisy variations. Okay. So here we have one particular curve. Right. So change in the instant descendants and see, you know, more on this side than on this side. If I had sort of curve, I have zero, and I see something like that, where this is descendant minus the ancestor. It's always positive. What does that suggest? So descendant mass is always greater than ancestor mass. They got bigger over time, right? And basically on every branch they got bigger over time. Whereas if it's this, what is that? It varied, right? And I could have something where it's like this. What does this suggest?
Like it's messing.
What else? Well, right, so one set of pairs stays near, you know, zero plus or minus, and another set are increasing, right? And it could be that this is the set where the instances are all at zero, right? And so at that point, you have to increase. And the other far enough away from zero, they don't interact with that border anymore. Or it could be that this is some sort of subgroup that's been selected for big size, like whales, and they're also sort of being wiggling around at some normal size. Good. So we do these answers in a pair to get at these direction of trends, and those trends are happening throughout history or only for certain groups. Okay. So here there's some evidence for being a little greater than zero, but not a lot. This overall great trend. And you see this overall, you know, maybe it happens in certain time periods, right? Maybe it wiggles near zero, except you know, being in the Eocene, it shoots up, something like that. And so this plot is looking at that.
we often see a thing above zero and below zero, but it goes back and forth.
Let's go with that. Okay, another way to look at this is on a tree.
So I take a tree, and now I map this way is time, and this way is, you know, body size, something like that. Right? And we plot a tree in this space. So I can see I've gone from a small ancestor to bigger, and now I start having some that are smaller, some that are bigger. Okay. And so again, here I can do, because the ancestors sit in pairs. This one with this one, so here, this one with this one, so here, and so forth. Right. These changes, so p minus q, that change. Okay. So I can plot these changes over as a function of where I used to be. Right. So once again, q is when it's smaller than it's bigger, right? Over here. So then down here, small values always have
even descendants. Make sense? And so, if you apply like this,
right, no matter what size ancestor I have, my descendant is always bigger.
Okay, which indicate what? Right, it's always being pushed towards bigger,
right? If I start off at size 0, I end up with size 0 plus 4. So if I size 20, I always end up with size 20 plus 4. Okay?
So it's always increasing. You'll see that on the plot? Understand that? No? Okay. So this is the change in descendant. So, you know, descendant value minus ancestor value. If ancestor is 20, then if descendant is 25, it would be up here. Right? So 25 minus 20, delta 5. Good.
Okay. Whereas here, you see, if I'm bigger than zero, what happens? In this area. Smaller. When it's smaller than zero, what happens?
Bigger, right? Which is him being sort of actively selected for being near zero. I get too big, I get lower, I get smaller, I get higher. Okay? Yeah.
So, you're going to put zero, but that's the change.
Zero. In this case,
right, because if, you know, anything above zero would have negative displacement. I could imagine taking this line and having it actually over here instead, such that we're crossing from zero to 40. Anything bigger than 40 has negative. Anything lower than 40 has positive. Change. Right. Is that clear?
So I guess, what would
the trade be? Oh, so oftentimes we do this stuff in log space. Okay, so everything like log base 10, we don't need to do log base 8, we need to do log 10. Right, so we have a value of, you know, 5 times 10 to the 2. I take the log of that, and that's 2 something. Right? If I have negative 2, it's negative 2 something. Right? So, in a log space, you have numbers going from negative to positive.
Oh, okay. So the size would be like, it's 5 times 10 to negative 2 in variance.
Right. You take the log of that rather than. Okay. And the reason we do that is for many of these models, I could say I can increase or decrease in size by, say, 5%. Probability, right? Like, no matter what my size is, right? So an elephant increases by 5%, or decreases by 5%, so can a mouse, right? Whereas an elephant can increase or decrease by 5 grams, one more easily than a mouse can increase or decrease by 5 grams, right? And so putting it in raw unit space isn't as good as putting it in log space, for this reason. So for a lot of these, we use a log transform. And we also imagine something about like angle of coiling, right? It could be positive or negative. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Okay. let's skip ahead a little bit. But basically, we can use this sort of plot to get at, you know, stable or unstable equilibria, right? Maybe if you're at some value, you always want to move away from it, to the unstable equilibrium, right? Where it's the only value. Or if you're near it, you always move towards it, which would be stable equilibrium. So get this sort of pattern as well. Okay. So here's some empirical examples where we have vertebrates and you're looking at skull size and you look at skull size through time. Try to see, you know, is there a positive or negative trend? Okay. More. Okay. There's the osteopods. And you see through a time, an average, a certain time period, also raw values, okay, and valve length. So what do you see?
See a trend or not? Hear no, to hear yes. Hear yes, okay. What is that? Yes, okay, so it's one no, two yeses. All right, fight, convince each other.
Okay, so it's
okay. Oh, cool. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. Right, so each job is a sample. So they have a bunch of samples and they have thin time bins. So, okay. I mean, yeah, so I could sort of draw lines like, and then something like that, maybe. Right? It's not a continual line, certainly. what they do in this paper is compare it to temperature. The blue line. So we see here.
And it's a little noisy when it jumps up and down, but there's an inverse relationship. This temperature increases, volume increases.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So, you know, as this gets smaller,
right. Does that prove that we're spotting the temperature? No. Why not? But it's not causation, right?
but it certainly is, you know,
it's very suggestive that it is causation. But you're right, it's not proving it. So
it would rule out the hypothesis that, you know, bigger temperature meant bigger valve. This would sort of rule it out. This allows it to be some other factor, or allows it to be temperature related, right? And then you can go and investigate it further.
Okay. Any questions about that? Okay. Now here's just other trends of how
head size. Body size has changed through time and previous years.
See a trend there.
And also, that's an ratio of the
okay. One other thing could lead it to a trend like the osteopod trend, I want to suggest. Imagine I have two clades, right? And this clade is bigger, so body size, than this clade is, right? They can also differ in multiple other traits too, right? So like I mentioned, this one could be predators using herbivores, right? So that's something that causes predators to do better. I could end up seeing more of these through time, right? And so I see a bigger, you know, a trend in, at first I have equal numbers, and then later on I have more of these, so the average size of species in this group is bigger, right? It's actually just this clade being, like, members of this clade being selected for some other trait, like being predators, rather than size itself, right? And so to control for that, in some way, we're using phylogeny, right? And see if, you know, if I have to compare sister groups, there's always the one that has the higher body size and become more common. And then simple why you need preference for logic. Okay. Any questions about trends? I mean, so trends in general are something that we seek to, you know, we see a lot in nature and we seek to explain, right? Both across space and across time. And so it shows some of the techniques we use to get at those questions. We can't directly experiment on. Anything else? All right, I'll see you on Friday.